I feel like I have an escape. Does everybody understand what I mean by I have an escape? Meaning I'm paying $50,000 for something maybe it costs $20,000 to put on the market, but maybe it's worth $200,000, and we sell it for $150,000. And we open and close escrow in a matter of 30 days, and we're kind of in and out of the deal, and we don't make like the big record sale prices, but that's just the plan that my partner and I kind of put together, and it seems to be working. If there was some wood, I'd be knocking on it right now, but exactly. But there's a lot of discussions because I personally have my fortune out on the table, okay, with this, and there's a lot of discussions I've had with my partner. That revolves around what are we going to do if something horrible happens to the economy or something happens horrible to the market. And so I want to caution all of you right now. What I'm not saying to you is that the market is bad. I'm not saying to you that we have to plan on the market dropping 30-40%. Okay, but I'm here because I want to be honest with you all, and I want to be able to tell you, yeah, I'm certainly concerned about it. And in the acquisition strategy that I've put together is centered around like a worst case scenario like this. And I wanted to spend like 15 minutes with you folks, kind of giving you an idea of something maybe you might want to look at or think about while you're purchasing, because I realize everybody here. John Schwab, One House at a Time. It's a great book. Okay, and if that's not your strategy today, though, okay, if that's not your strategy today, maybe you're trying to buy, fix, and sell for income. Maybe you're buy, fixing, and selling, and you're gonna sell four homes, and you're gonna keep the fifth one. I don't know exactly what the strategy that you're personally gonna go for, but that's how I started doing this. I started doing it for income, and moved on from there. But the cornerstone of the concern, or I read an article in one of the real estate publications that I get at the house, and it talked about purchasing for replacement costs. So it's easy to say that, but I want to expand on that to you guys. So any home that I'm talking about. Homes in today's market cost around $200 a square foot to build, okay? So if you have a 2,000 square foot house, at $200 a square foot, I think that's $400,000, okay? Plus you've got dirt, plus you've got connections, sewer, electrical, all of this kind of stuff. Which on a house like that, is probably going to cost $75,000, something like that. So I like this what I'm saying to you guys right now, because I don't think this is crazy or out of the ordinary. So for instance, I have a home that I'm looking at right now. Now this home came to me from one of my contacts. He's a furniture broker, what am I trying to say here? Yeah, like an estate sales guy, okay? So all of you should have 2, 3, 4, 5 estate sales guys that you call up and you say, hey, I buy houses. If anyone is selling their furniture and they haven't sold the house, I'd love to make an offer. And that's actually how I hooked up with this guy. He called me, said, hey, I've got this property. It's 1,100 square feet. It's in Riverside, Indiana and Jackson, and it's a very working class, like first time buyer sort of neighborhood. The roof is low, and in fact, the heating and air conditioning kind of comes out the they have the tubes up on the top of the house. It's rough, okay, but the math works out really well, okay. So at $200 a square foot at 1,100. At 1,100 square feet, I think that's $220,000 plus, let's just say $75,000 for the lot itself. So, you know, we're looking at somewhere around $290,000 purchase, and I'm well underneath that. So what I like about these formulas, and what I like about offering you guys a way to do a fast, detailed analysis, okay? So what happens to me is people, a lot of the faces that I see here in the club, they call me. And I know Evan gets the phone call too, and it's like, hey, I got this property. And what I want you guys to be thinking about, especially, great, maybe the market stays just the way it is. Maybe interest rates wane and they drop a little bit from where they're at, and the market catches fire again, and we have another, you know, 15 years of greatness. I mean, I don't know. It doesn't seem all that likely that we're going to get something like that. But with that said, okay, having a stopgap, or having a place that you won't go to, and really all I'm talking about is getting your money back. So I was talking with Shirley in the back earlier, talking about, you know, getting into these deals and getting out quick. Okay, now that's just what I do. I'm not saying it's the only way to go, but having a guardrail on your road as you're going is really what I'm talking about. So $200 a square foot minus land cost minus utilities at least gives you a place to start at, okay? Then from there, now, do most of you work with real estate agents? How about anyone raising their hands? Anyone buying property, do they have an agent that they call? Okay, so I didn't see a lot of hands. So you, if you're buying property without an agent, I don't think doesn't scare me. But they offer you a lot of information, and a lot of agents, I wouldn't lie to them. I wouldn't say, hey, I'm going to have you sell the house unless you were going to do that for sure. But a lot of agents will give you a packet of information. And one of the things that I've gotten good at, and this is all part of, you know, buying in a down market and getting the proper information. So for instance, how many properties in a particular zip code were sold last month? Okay, there's a term in the new home industry, we used to call it absorption. So what absorption means is in any given month, 10 houses sell in a submarket. So a submarket would be a zip code, let's just say, okay? So if 10 houses sell and there's 60 houses available to sell, that means that your house, there's a 6-month supply of real estate in the market. Does everybody understand that? Okay, so if the number is lower than 6 months, okay, now this is the corporate side that I work with pretty extensively back in the day. The corporate side of this would say, if there is a 6-month supply of real estate on the market, or under a 6-month supply, it is pretty much a seller's market, because they can pretty much, there's not a lot of property available, and you're going to be hard pressed to find a deal. So back in 2010 and 11, you were selling back then, were you? Just started? Yeah. So I was a pretty active agent in like 2010, 11, 12, and I can tell you right now that you'd be looking for a house, and you'd put in, you know, the parameters, because back then you could go on the MLS and look for a repos, REO, real estate owned by the bank, and there would only be 12 or 13 houses in your little zip code that had sold for the month, and there were 190 houses. There was a massive amount of inventory, and that's why the houses got so inexpensive. That's why so you can see this would be a really big factor in determining that. So one of the things, and one of the reasons I think that all of you should find a pet real estate agent to work with, okay, to have somebody that's there all the time, because what you should do is you should ask them every month to run active, pending, backup, and closed. You want to know, is that number increasing or decreasing? Are there more actives? Are there more under contracts? Are there more solds? And you want to understand those numbers. And I'm not as good as I used to be back in the day. But this was a report I did all the time, and it made me understand exactly how strong the market was, what I'm talking about is actives to under contracts, okay? So you're looking at, so the market, you know, in 2 months, in 6 months, in a year, there's a change, that the market changes all the time. But if you're in your sub-market, so everyone understands what I mean by sub-market. Like, for instance, I live by La Sierra University off the 91 in Pierce. That's where I live. My little sub-market is that whole area kind of north from the 91 freeway. I know it very well. I look at a lot of houses up there. But I know, like, days on market over there are 8 days. So anything that goes on the market, so my neighbor is selling his house. Guess what? I'm just gonna help him sell the house. I show him how to put signs up and take phone calls with him, because there's just not a lot of property on the market. So if you can offer a home for sale, and somehow justify a price, and it's usually going to be a record price. I don't know. I do a lot of work on Zillow and the other one, Redfin. So that's always my first look, okay? And what I notice is the prices have never been higher. And that's really why I decided to come here and tell all of you what I'm saying about buying in a down market, okay? Because what I know is things that top out, you know, sometimes they keep going, but after we've been doing this for 15 years, I don't know, maybe it will keep going. But I want you guys to be very cautious, okay, of the fundamentals. How many houses are for sale in the submarket? How many houses sold, okay? Is it above or below a 6 month supply of real estate? All of these to me are very, very important, even way more so than what the interest rates are. In my lifetime, I've seen interest rates go up really high, and although everybody seems to be saying that the interest rates bring this high are stopping sales, I don't believe they are. I think the problem is the people don't want to sell because they're locked into a low rate. I think people will just spend, you know, they'll just spend money like the government gives it to them. I'm telling you guys right now, this is really what I came here to say, because I don't want to be the third base coach that's just waving you guys home. Okay, what I've seen I don't know if you guys listened to the three of us had the podcast, and Evan told a really great story of his family. This was in the 70s. Building strip malls, strip centers. You know, everybody had a company car. I'll bet everyone had a charge card. I'll bet everybody went to Disneyland. I bet it was really fun, okay? And I know this because, well, that's his story is really similar to mine. It's kind of funny. My dad was a real estate investor, and really quickly got 20 houses in Orange County for like $80,000 each. Now, they were worth $79,000, and you know, he just couldn't ride the storm, and he lost all of it. Okay, so I'm not trying to, again, guys, most of my fortune that I personally possess is involved in real estate right now. So I'm not trying to tell you not to do this. What I'm telling you is to be sober. What I'm telling you is it's really easy. Believe me, guys, it's really easy to think that every deal is gonna make you millions of dollars, or, you know, what was the figure that you guys are gonna make up in the mountains? You thought you were hoping you were gonna make? Yeah, Yeah, and the reality of that is that you is I have a lot of deals like that that I you know I don't even tell my wife the number anymore because it's never true, you know. And it's not because I'm a liar. It's just because I'm an optimist. Because I'm a drunkard. Does everybody hear my jokes here? It's like I'm a drunkard in the sense that I really do believe we can sell it and make 120 grand. But how much did the scaffolding cost around that property? Yeah, just $9,500. And I bet you it took almost a month once you determined you had to do it to when it was actually set up. So now you got an extra 2 months. There you go. Look, see? Always the optimist. I'm a drunkard. Do you guys understand what I'm saying? Okay. Yeah. And it just goes on and on and on and on. So, again, how many houses are listed in the submarket? How many closed? I don't mean how many. So does everybody understand the difference between active? They don't call it pending anymore. What do they call it? They do? Okay, active, pending, and then do they call? They still do backups? Okay, active and under contract, and then closed. So what I'm talking about is active properties plus under contract properties divided by the closed. Okay, and if it's more than a 6 month supply, I would understand right now that the seller has less. The seller has less power in that because there's just that many homes on the market. And I remember this would have been 2008. I was selling or 2007. I was selling homes in Victorville. I had multiple communities out there, and really, really, it took a while for it to kind of reverberate up the hill. But all of my buddies that were selling at I was at a new home company. All of them were selling in Orange County. All of them that were selling in Corona, you know, that whole area over there by Limonite was being built back then. Overnight, the market stopped. Okay, so. As long as you've accounted for the idea that scaffolding that you weren't counting on costs $9,600. These are two of the most experienced guys in the room that made that mistake, and I don't mind. They know it. I don't mind. I'm not rubbing it in. Okay. I'm just saying that. Yeah, well, yeah, there you go. No, please, everybody, we're all learning. One of the guys earlier, we were in there, and he goes, "Yeah, I've been making a lot of mistakes," or whatever it is. I think that's really what I'm here to tell you guys about. You guys hear me? I'm kind of I kind of give myself a hard time on stage. I don't mind doing it because we screw up all the time. If you make a lot of decisions, You're gonna screw up. And what I want you guys to be doing is just like I was saying. I want you to be sober about this. I want you to say, you know, if this doesn't happen, if the two, you know, biggest things that you're thinking are gonna happen, that's why you're gonna make $1 million. If those two don't happen, are you gonna lose $1 million, or are you're just gonna lose $10,000? I don't know. And I'm just asking for all of you to look at it this way, and in the end, all it's going to do is just make you a better investor. It's going to make you a way better investor. I can tell you guys right now, we've been doing this 4 months. We got 12 properties, and the hardest job that I have with my partner is cash flow management. Okay, because we got new deals every day that are coming to us. We can't get them all. So which ones are we going to get? We still have construction on 4 different properties we haven't completed. There's a lot in the equation, and that's what I want you guys to see. You notice I'm not talking about drywall. I'm not talking about the painter. I'm not talking about scaffolding, you know. I'm talking about cash flow management. I'm talking about the business part of the transaction, and I would like I personally, I know Evan feels the same way. I'd like for all of us to be talking more about this part of the business, because it's what's going to make you wealthy. You know, it's what's gonna sustain itself. When the market gets bad, there's gonna be a lot of people that are panicking. And if you have a hardened plan, okay, like I'll say it to you guys right now. Our plan is if something bad like this happens, well, we'll just take out all the profit in the deal, and I want to get my cash back, and I'll just restart a couple months later, but I'll get my money back. You know, do you understand what I'm saying? I'll get my nest egg. I'll get my, that little golden egg that I got. I'll get it back, and even if I don't make if I don't make any money on the actual transaction and I just get my money back, I'm a big, big, big winner. One of the characters in the club called me, he asked me about doing business out of state. And please, guys, I'm not dogging anyone for doing business out of state. It's a whole nother donkey that you're riding. You know what I'm saying? It's a whole nother group of problems. It's a whole nother, you know, group of things. And essentially, he had a nest egg, and he was guarding all of his profit, and because he was guarding his profit so much, that ended up just falling apart, and now his nest egg is at risk. And you know, he's I don't know exactly what he's doing with that transaction, but I'll say it because I didn't say his name. It's poor planning, and it's thinking that the market's always going to go up. It's thinking, and if you just got in this business 3 years ago, or you just started thinking about doing this business 3 years ago, it's easy to think that it always goes up. The people I follow on the internet talk about if there's a dip in the market, it'll be the greatest transfer of wealth in the history of our world. Okay, I like that. The greatest transfer of wealth in the history of our world. So I want to be on the plus side of that equation. I don't want to be on the hey, the guy, you know, that Jim gave me $1 million. Thanks, Jim. Yeah, I don't want to be that guy, okay? But it takes, again, sober planning. And this is a great topic. I love it. If any of you are interested in talking more about it, I'll be happy to give you the best I have. And that's all I have, seeing how we're live from the fire center. I just love saying that. All right. So without any further ado, I remember him. I remember when I first started hanging out with this guy, I loved it because sincere, good questions. And now look at him. Now look at him. He's got this... I'm really happy with your business. What you guys don't know is I get to hang out with them every month. We go to breakfast. It's nice to hear that I'm not the only one that has these problems, or dealing with our families, or dealing with our planning. It's really nice. But everybody, welcome Evan.
Thanks, buddy. Thank you. Let's give it up for Jim. What a lot of you don't know, I'll share about Jim, is that years ago when he came to the club, he was been around since it was originally founded or shortly thereafter, and he had met another person in the room that became his partner. Thank you. Okay. And they went on and made millions of dollars together, and they both met at the club. And they partnered up in a way to where the other guy was the money guy, but Jim had all the selling experience and all this other experience. And together, they literally made millions of dollars. All from looking around and seeing who was weak in one area and who was strong in an area. And that relationship lasted for many years until his partner passed away. Right? Right? Yeah. So when you talk to Jim, that there is a lot of experience there. So he didn't have all the hard money payments, like a lot of us do, because he partnered up with that person and they just split everything. So they didn't have the negative carry like a lot of people do, because it was a partnership. So, but anyway, did very well together. First of all, real quick, I just wanted to I tell you though, I wanted to add that real quick, but really excited to be here. Something that Jim said, I want to add to it. A year ago, we brought out at a round table, Nick Manfredi, Chrissy Kurtwell and I, we all got up and spoke about what was going on in the economy, because a year ago, I was far more worried than I am now, because I'm not that worried. Because I said then, and I've turned out to be true, I've talked to Nick about this, here's the thing, when you have this many buyers and this many sellers, I don't care if there's low inventory or high inventory. Guess what? Keeps the prices up, and it keeps that competition there. It's when one gets weird that you have problems, and we haven't seen it. Still low inventory. And as long as you have low inventory, a lot of the buyers have gone away because they couldn't qualify, so it's kept those prices up. And so even with, this is what's interesting, even if they don't raise interest rates, which I just heard today that they're not, someone shared that with me, even if they start dropping them, all those other people that do have those 3% that might go well, they're willing to pay 6, they start throwing it on the market, those buyers that backed off because they didn't like 7, 8% are going to go, now it's 6.5, and they're going to jump back in, it's going to keep doing this, and so I'm not too worried about it. When Angela and I started, the market was doing this, 2009, okay, they were dropping. We bought in that market, bought in a flat market, and slowly we just rode the up wave for the last 5 years. I had two experienced friends, both made a lot of money flipping, one in rentals, etc. They, for the last 5 years, haven't been doing a lot of flipping. They were either enjoying life, doing other things, and I thought they missed the wave because it was a really good wave that was just nice to do it. But one other thing about something, about even if you buy something, as long as it cash flows, there's one of the guys in the room we were talking earlier, and he bought a house in San Diego for in the $200,000, $240,000. And today, because he sat on it, he's rented all these years, worth over $1 million. So buying and holding that strategy for the long run, you're good. As long as it's cash flowing, it's in a good area. And keep that in mind, okay? So again, I don't know too many people that bought a place, had it for 30 years, and lost. Okay? Unless they didn't have fire insurance and the house burned down. All right. We're going to go over a couple things real quick because I only have about 20 minutes here. Let's see if I can operate this. Basically, this is really about getting a property and a contract in 6 weeks or getting a deal. I gave this before, but I've got to condense this in and make shorten it up. First of all, about me, I'm a fix and flipper. Been doing this for about 15 years. We buy and hold. We do wholesale deals. I like mobile homes and parks and land. If you've taken Andy Teese's class, that's really good. We made a lot of money with that. And I love mobile homes for cash flow, okay? Two of our websites that we deal with, SureCash Deals and Sell the House. I'm just going to go into this, tell you, remember, I was new once too, all right? Angela and I worked 50, 60 hours a week. We had an hour, hour and a half commute to and from Corona to Anaheim Hills to go 13 miles, 45 minutes to an hour, hour and a half. And if the freeway was backed up, it could take 3 hours because you had to go around through Carbon Canyon to get to work. And you'd call your boss and go, I don't know how I'm going to get in, and I'll be there in 3 hours, and we'll figure it out, or we'll wait. But we didn't really have any money. And what little money we had in the beginning, we bought a couple rentals, and then we ran out of money. So we didn't know where to start, no experience. That was us. It was just us down the road a little bit. All right? Anyone can relate? Anyone relate to that? All right. Been there. Well, I just knew that if I could get going, if I could figure out real estate and rentals, that I'd be fine. You know, something Angela and I talked about. I just had to figure out how to get started. So for me, this is where it started. Let's see if it does this. It's not going to play? It should. Well, wait, maybe. Oh, there we go. Watch it. It's my daughter. This was an REO.
What?
Anyone see the cot? Anyone see the cot in that living room? All right, that's where you start. You do what you have to do, because I would go from Corona, Anaheim Hills, 13 miles, then drive all the way out to San Bernardino, which was a 50 miles. We'd work so many hours, and either spend the night, did that a few times a week, or spent the weekend, that I'd come back. I hired my ex-wife's boyfriend to show me how to lay a floor. I called my wife's ex-husband, Richard's dad, and said, hey, I'm going to take apart this 4x4 countertop. I don't know what's underneath it. What am I going to get? And he goes, get eye protection. You're going to get 4 inches of concrete. He was right. And I busted all that out. And I think he laughed the whole time because I thought I'd do it in like a few, like an hour or something. Took me like half the day. Anyway, that's where it started. Look like I know what I'm doing? Yes. Still breathe funny though because of it. But that was actually in the second rental we bought, $65,000 because he bought it. That was an REO again. You just, lots of homes on the market. He was right. 10 houses that sell and 200 were on the market. It was crazy. But guess what? As soon as we had that little bit of money, bought a couple houses, and we had the same problem. We're out of money again. What do we do? No idea. Finally found a REIA. That was something. Didn't even know what they were. And that's where I met Nick Manfredi, those of you who know Nick. But really, I saw those guys on TV. Oh, they'll show me how to make money, right? They wanted my money. So what they did is we went to a three-day seminar. I literally dragged Angela to it right here to the convention center, whichever direction that is, right next to the Marriott, okay? And we paid $1,500 for 3 days, and we did not have it. We literally put everything into the houses, the couple of houses we had, and she was like, you're paying what? How much? Because $1,500, that's like $5,000 today or a million. It felt like a million. Put it on a credit card. That's what we did. And you know what? I learned how to raise money. I learned that you could partner with an IRA. They didn't tell me how other than you can do it. I had to go figure that out. I didn't have a club. No one, you know what I mean? I didn't have that. And how to create partnerships. And out of that, we created two partnerships that we still have today, 15 years later, 14 years later, whichever it is. One of those partnerships, we never put a dime in. All right? It just never put a dime in. But we started doing a couple deals a year. Just a couple deals a year is what we started. Two or three. You don't have to do 50 deals a year when you hear some of us talk about, or Jim does 5 deals in a week or whatever. You know, don't worry about it. You just do one. That's the idea about John Schaub and building wealth one house at a time. That is a foundation for your business, okay? Building Wealth One House at a Time, Invest in Debt by Jimmy Napier, Richest Man in Babylon, Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and Retire Young, Retire Rich. Those are some of the best books that also have to deal with mindset and what we're doing here. So I also learned the importance of association and hanging out, because I had a lot of friends that wanted to talk about the Dodger game or this game, or they wanted to do this and they wanted to do that. Everything else about their crappy marriage or whatever. They would talk about all these other things. And I was like, I wasn't hanging around that. I didn't have that. I had some really good friends. But I didn't have any friends that were doing well, other than the owner where we worked. And he was doing really well because Angela and I made sure we put a lot of money in his pocket. And we were getting a wage, punched a time card, and all that. So we went to that three-day seminar and learned a lot. And it was the best thing when I learned to start putting money into my own education. And that was a key. All right? And that's something we never stopped doing. Real quick, how many deals have you guys done now? Who's never done a deal? Real estate deal? Never. Okay, who's done 5 and under? Okay, who's done more than 50? Okay, I just want to know who I'm talking to. Okay, just keep that in mind. All right, listen, a year ago, Richard, I, Angela, were sitting in that bay. We were in the Caribbean. And while we were sitting there, I was really having a reflection because a guy named Mitch Stevens, who's another investor from the Investor Addicts Cruise, came over and I was watching them, they were talking to him, and we were sitting there and certain things were hitting me as I was listening to the conversation and going over the entire cruise and all the investors we were with and some of the things that really illustrated a couple things. And so while I was laying out thinking about this, it got me thinking. And it really kind of hit me then, and this was something that's really important. And I tried to put it together, and then I got back. I called Jim. I said I called my friend, but I called Jim and said, hey, you want to get together? We got together for breakfast. And what we talked about was, by the way, first of all, when I say laying out, this is me laying out. I have to do this. If I don't, I end up like that. Okay, real quick. Just so you know, disclosure, okay? I just burn like a lobster. Those two, they can tan. I can't. It's not fair. It's Italian blood. But back to my thing with Jim. We were talking, and what we were talking about is what separates those people that are doing deals regularly and those who don't. Okay? That was really who separates it. Because a lot of you can fall into a deal, but what separates those from regularly doing a deal versus not? And that's what we kind of talking about. And like I said, certain things hit me. And it was like, what, how, why, when, what separates those? And so I just want to make sure that you really think about that. What does separate that? And I want to make sure you're ready to hear this, because I need you to think about really much what I'm about to ask. And what it comes down to is, first of all, is if you knew you couldn't fail, what would your goals be? If you knew you couldn't fail, what would your goals be? Would there be, well, I think I can meet somebody sometime in the next month, or maybe I'd make a call. If you knew whatever your goal was, you wouldn't fail, what would it be? I really want you to think about it. You don't have to answer right now, but I want you to answer yourself. What is your goal? What is it? What are you aiming for? If you just jumped in the car because you're going to go visit family and they live in Indiana and you head north, kind of a problem, all right? You're going the wrong way. You follow me, all right? So you want to have an idea of where you're headed in the first place, and then why. But first of all, if you knew you couldn't fail, what would your goals be? How would your life be different? How many of you have a job? How many of you have a job that you still answer to somebody? I don't mean to your wife or husband. Okay, you still have a job. All right. Would you keep that? How many of you, raise your hand if you have a job. This is okay. How many would keep that job if you made $1 million a year? Okay, maybe one. Yeah, some love their job. That's okay. Rich and I have sold a deal to a guy, and they just tried to buy our other flip that I think Richard's going to talk about in the mountains, kept trying to buy it. He loves his job. He's an engineer. He just loves what he does. So even though he makes a lot of money in real estate and in online business, guess what? Still goes to work because he loves it. That's not me. That's him. But, what would you do? Again, think about it. If you couldn't fail, what would you do? What would you change? Me? I'd ride motorcycles more, travel more with my wife, and eat more tacos. That's just me, okay? So one of the things here is, look, if you did 4 deals this year, okay, and made $25,000 average, notice how I didn't write $100,000 average flip. I didn't write $500,000 flip, okay? I wrote $25,000, all right? Would $100,000 extra this year be success to you? Would that help? Who would $100,000 help? I know it helped me. Because that'd be a really nice trip to Europe. Not to spend $100,000 on, but anyway. But would it have a serious impact in your life? Just think about it, really, seriously. Because if you don't get up off your butt on that Saturday, because Netflix, and you're sitting on that Barca lounger, and it's just washing over you, as you want to watch Rocky IV for the 5th time, or Star Wars again. Well, it doesn't matter which version. You want to do that. All right, and you got to think about your reasons why and your goals, et cetera, and you're thinking about Netflix. It's okay if you're where you want to be in life to go ahead and watch Netflix. I do, but I can afford to do that now, okay? So, but think about that. That extra $100,000, I really want you to go with that. I want you to think what it would do. And a lot of things, remember, it's not just the money. It's what the money can do for you. So how would that impact your life? Would your wife quit her job? Could you bring her home? Maybe your kids aren't in daycare anymore. Maybe you could travel more. Maybe you could just sleep better at night. Maybe you could just look at a menu from the left side to the right side without having to look at the right side to the left side. Who can relate to that? I used to do that. No one can relate to doing that? Wow, you guys just order whatever you want, never look at prices? Angela and I talk about this. She can remember when I stood at a Big Five debating whether I could spend $5, no joke, on a tarp, because we would go backpacking. $5. I just don't know. So anyway, we're going to put that aside for a minute. What is your fire number? Who took the fire class? All right? Awesome. Who knows what a fire number is? Who doesn't know what a fire number is? Okay. Fire number is that number for financial independence, that job, that number is going to get you, that pays all your bills. Think of your monthly nut. Think of a squirrel and acorns and all that. What's covering all your expenses? Not, well, hey, if I won $1 million and I had $30,000 a month, it'd be wonderful. What is it today? My mentor, Mick, at Mick's Lunch said, don't come back next week without that answer. So I had to go talk to Ange, figure out what do we really spend on what, where are we at? Because I had an idea. And when I came back and I told him, he laughed at me because, what are you trying to be, like a millionaire or something? Because he was trying to say that, no, you keep looking at, oh, if everything was perfect in the world. He's like, no, what are your bills? What's your car payment? What's your credit card? What is that? That's your freedom number. That's the number that gets you out of the job and worrying about everything so you can focus on how to make a life. And that's what Robert Kiyosaki talks about as well, especially in his book, Retire Young, Retire Rich. What is your fire number? You should know that before your head hits the pillow tonight, or you're not serious about making money, not about passive income. What is that number? What could you, if you stopped and stayed on a beach for a year, would your business survive? All right? So, but what is that number? You don't have to tell me, but you need to know what your number is. I know what our number is. Our number has changed over the years. It's gone up, but our income's gone up. But that's okay. So what's your fire number? And what are you willing to get there? I always talked about Netflix and all the other stuff. What are you willing to do? You willing to work 10 hours a week, 15 hours a week, 50? All I knew is if I could drive an hour to work or 2 hours to work for someone else, I could do it for myself. All right? If I could work a 24 or 36-hour shift for somebody else, I could put a few extra miles on my car to go work for us. All right? So some of you go, oh, that's kind of far to drive to Yucaipa to look at that. Some of you have said that to me, and I wanted to laugh. All right? So keep that in mind. So what separates those who do deals and those that don't? All right? That's really what it comes down to. What Jim and I talked about, et cetera. What separates those, okay? Comes down to mindset is a big part of it because we know certain things, all right? And it does because we believe it, we know it. And so first of all, look where you want to go. And I love this quote, as I think, so I feel, as I feel, so I do, as I do, so I have. That's from someone named Joseph McClendon. Richard and I are fortunate to be able to be in a group setting and work with him. He's a neuro-linguistic. He talks about how you do certain patterns and certain behaviors, and that's why you should be very careful what you say to yourself. And, oh, I hate cold calling. No, you love cold calling, all right? Because guess what happened? You want to go do that more, even if you really hate cold calling. You got to trick yourself, okay? So the other thing with the mindset, though, is that there are plenty of deals, all right? There is plenty of money. I sat down with someone the other day next to me that literally had $50 million in cash that he's like, my problem is I have too much money. So nothing really much motivates him. And I was like, I could help you with that. He's like, 30 grand on a deal, 50 grand, yeah. I asked to interview him. I do plan to have him here and interview him. That's coming. I know it. That's coming. He was like, maybe. Anyway, but the whole idea is there is no maybe, can I find a deal? There is no, can someone talk me out of real estate? Hey, Evan, I just want you to know, I heard you talk about real estate, and that's a bad thing to do. You could lose a lot of money. Yeah, I know you can. But do I think that it doesn't work? You think anyone's in that? No, we have rentals, we flip, we wholesale. That is not going to happen, okay? It can't because we've already had some success. But a new person starting out, I'm going to go make money in real estate? You can have an issue with that mindset. Is this for me? Can I do it? Am I in the right place? Do I know people? Jim partnered up with his partner and did a lot of deals. There's a lot of people in this room that have done a lot of deals. There's a lot of people in this room that have done more than 50, or several of you, and a lot have done between 5 and 50. And your future partner, you got to always check people out, might be sitting next to you. They might be strong where you're weak. All right. I wanted partners because I wanted to spread the risk a little bit. And I had a confidence issue, but in between the two, it worked out really well. Just saying. So the other thing is mindset. It's also action. You have to take action. And so that's where it goes. We set goals. We plan for the future. We look for solutions. We know real estate is a great vehicle. We take action. We find deals, develop them, nurture them, and close them. Those are things we do. We don't just, one day as I go to work and everything and do nothing else and never say anything, et cetera. You can fall into it. You ever hear that joke about the woman that kept saying, I want to win the lottery. God, I want to win the lottery. Why, God, why am I not winning the lottery? And finally she gets, you need to buy a ticket. There are people, trust me. So understand this about mindset and action. Understand it's about, that's why I'm a big believer on ready, fire, and aim. Get out there and have action. If you're not worried about certain things, we'll go into it real quick. I'm going to talk about a couple of things real quick. We did this deal. It's a tired landlord, two properties. This is about where we got some deals recently. I'm going to do that. Tired landlord, two properties. We wholesaled, made $70,000 a few months ago. One deal. Called up someone. Richard said, hey, we're going to send this out. I was like, yeah. And then we turned out, we ended up selling it to a friend because there was a lot of things going on. and I mean a couple hours on it, and then later there was some other things with it, but $70,000. Did another one, a wholesale deal, partnered with someone. That's what happens when you have to change things and at the last minute. I partnered with somebody. Partnered? Is that a Texas thing? We wholesaled that recently, and we made $60,000 with someone. Did another one, an overwhelmed owner, and wholesale in Muskoy, made $35,000. Okay, what was that, 200 grand, something like that? High desert probate title issues. We just got court approval on this. We're putting it up, and we should make $50,000, $60,000 on this. I'm just calling to get the sign off, and that'll be going up for sale soon in the high desert. So these were a lot of our last deals came from. It's nightmare property. Just someone's father died. They need property evaluations. And then we had multiple leads. And I'm going to just see a list. Some of them are the same. There was a lot of things there that I brought from another one, from another speech. But the point is, like these here, these were all recent deals. Okay, a couple hundred thousand. Remember when I said that extra 100 grand? Okay, that 100,000 is happening right now, whether you do another thing or not, whether you go home or not. It's that 100,000 is available to you right now if you get up off your butts and do something and say something and talk about it. Every single one of those was a referral. Okay, those of you who saw Pete. Pete said, I think he worked with four families and has done 71 transactions. Well, one of these deals, I met a woman at it's a friend of mine at a motorcycle event a motorcycle ride that I do, and she was talking. She worked for her dad, who was a flipper for 50 years, and he passed away. And she was having this struggle with all this, and she was just behind the computer. She didn't know the real estate side, so she asked me some evaluations. So we gave her some evaluations on the house. Some of you walked in one of her houses back in Rialto earlier in the year. All right, because we helped give her a valuation for her partner to buy them out. And we looked at it and said, no, it's not working for us. But I said, hey, my wife's an agent if you want to sell any of them. She sold several houses for them. All right, and made another like 20 grand from a conversation and from my posts. And I say what I say as I ride motorcycles, et cetera. And we got a text the other day from her saying they got three more coming, and there's a fourth we already know about, that she's going to have about $2.5 million in listings, which is like another, I don't know, 40 grand, 30 grand, 40 grand that's coming just because we do what we do. That landlord that I talked about, I've known him for like 10 years. I just, hey, if you ever want to sell, you know, just do that. Then there's the mountain home. One mountain home member, I don't have a lot of time. We're doing this one mountain flip. We thought we were going to make like 90,000. It's more like 40,000, 45,000. Close next week. But I get my money back. But you know what? A win is a win. Win is good enough. Oh, we're going to make 100. We're only making 45. Oh, that sucks. I used to spend all year to make 40 grand at a job punching a time. Yeah, okay. So anyway, Los Angeles burnout, 39,000. We shared with two couple partners. Okay, again, here's a bunch. Mobile on land, mountain home, LA deal, some other mobile home parks. I'm going to go quick. All of those are driving for a dollar, mailer, or Skip Tracy knocking on doors. So I just showed you hundreds of thousands of dollars of profit that we made either from referrals or driving for dollars. And it was either a mailer or knocking, Skip Tracing, whichever. Just those two, not everything else. Just something real easy to do. But if you go back and look at what's just referrals, again, with people you know, a lot of you are afraid to tell your friends really what you do. You're afraid, and I've seen it because I've talked to you. And you're like, no. It's like, hey, give me your phone. I'll call a few of them. It's like, no, when I'm successful, when I made some money, because they know I drive a 20-year-old car. They know I got negative $27 in the bank. Yeah, that's why you need this. But these are a couple things that I've been there. I have some tenants that are there too. So understand, these are some other deals, and some of these a little bit older, but one of the club members saw a condo. He tracked down the owner, made a deal, earned some money. And the same seller with him, he did another deal, wholesaled a triplex and made money. Wholesaled two deals, I think he made 20, 25 grand, and then bought a single family residence up north. And Steve lent the money on that deal. I think between all of it, this guy did real well, and et cetera. And a buddy of mine made 150 grand from referrals. And opened his mouth, on the MLS, and one was a referral, one was the MLS, $140,000, $150,000. Some of you met him and been in a flip earlier in the year with him that I took you to. Anyway, if you notice something about my friend here, anyone know who this is? Adrian, yeah. If you notice something, I'm going to show you this too. There he is on the right. You see this right here? There he is with his my wife buys mobile homes. Go back to his good side. Rich wants to look at that again. Hey, here's the thing. Here's the thing. You know how much money he makes? You'd get in a Speedo too if you knew. All right. Now the whole point is, those of you who are more like don't want to be the one to instigate a conversation. He wears certain clothing. He wears that. Look at this. I want to show you something. Look at Rich. He wears an inland. This is the one time I'm not wearing a sell thy house shirt or something that says we buy houses. But if you look at it, this was just an investor addict shirt. If you could look at the back, it talks about it. But Rich is wearing the Inland Empire Real Estate Investment. Adrian managed to have his shirt made with his logo. Or was it a sticker?
I think so.
Yeah, okay. Point is he went ahead and upped that up again because that's the way people approach. How many of you have been approached because you forgot this was on? I've had people, three or four, approach me in the last month and a half just asking, hey, what's that about? Because I forget it's on, right? Am I the only one?
I'm going to start forgetting.
Wow, start forgetting. They go, what's that? Okay, I was in line today at Chipotle, and while I was there, I had a book. I put the book down real quick. I put the book down. I did not have a business book. It was a historical book, and someone made a comment. This guy behind the counter says, oh, that looks like an interesting book. I said, yeah, it's a diversion from all the real estate investing books I read. I've always wanted to do that, et cetera. Next year, I'm talking about the club, talking about what's going on. It happened to me twice today. The other one was we were looking at an RV, and I handed the guy my card, and he goes, oh, you're a real estate investor. I always wanted to do that. What's that called, wholesaling? I'm like, all right, let me give you, here's the club info, here's the other. All right, that's twice today. Today, Angela was a witness, okay? Yeah, I just handed a card. So again, what we're saying is that there's money just passing you guys by. These are just a couple of ways. Right now, we're finding deals in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. Some of them were partnered up, all right? That's why I'm a big believer in partners, whether it's short-term, long-term. Because if you're afraid of something or not, when you two are working together and you guys are planning to meet Saturday to go do something, you tend to go, oh, I had to cancel. I wouldn't do it, but because Lee thinks I'm going to, all right, I got to go. And guess what? You go out there and you do it. Especially when you tell Steve, Steven says, I've got 200 grand, I'm willing to partner with you on something. And you're like, I got to find a home for this 200 grand. Hey, we're going to do a deal together, right? Because he's going to, hey, you find my money yet? You find a place for my money yet? Anyone ever have that call? I've had it. One of my original lenders says, hey, you know, I got 200,000, 250,000 sitting. Hey, just let me know before I deploy it somewhere because I don't know, okay? So keep this in mind. Understand a couple things. It's all about mindset and taking action and doing things and opening your mouth. Hey, this is what I do. And real quick, those of you who are worried about, hey, but I'm new, I don't know what to do. The bottom line is, I just say, you could say, hey, Steve, just so you know, this is Evan. I know it's been a while. I hope the wife's doing well. Just so you know, I became a real estate investor. I wanted you to know I'm doing that on the side. I work with a great group of people out of Riverside, California. If you ever have any real estate questions or needs or anything, please don't hesitate to reach out. I may not know the answers, but one of them will. Okay? Something along that line. So when you go, well, I don't have the credibility, you're right. Al does, Marta does, Angela does, Rich does. See what I mean? Some of you own 8, 10, 12, 15 rentals in here, and you're making a lot of money. And you're like, I'm not really sure what to do. You have a lot of success. It's just how you look at it, okay? Anyway, that's all I have time for today. Rich is coming up. Just want to tell you, I'm really proud of him. And in the last, 5-6 years, watching him take off and do a lot of his own thing, and he's got a rental portfolio and doing some other stuff, and he's about to take control of another property in Crestline. And again, constantly excited about it. Plus, did I tell you, we just got an accepted offer and we're going to get all of our money back and make some. Here. Yay. Give it up for Rich, everyone.
There you go. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
I almost wanted to just let you keep talking. Isn't he good? Yeah. Jim, too. Jim. Jim, you know, when I had to write that check for the $9,500 for the scaffolding, and it was just like, I really didn't want to write that check. I remembered some of the stories you used to tell me, and you still do, about things that didn't go your way for 10 times that. And, you know, I knew it was going to be okay. So, if you ever want to feel better about losing money, talk to Jim. Because he also has made it tenfold back, 150-fold back. So, good stuff, good stuff. So, I want to talk a little bit about the top way I'm finding deals at the moment. I know Evan just went through some of it. We do partner on some deals, but we also do our own stuff as well. So, let's hit it. A little background on me. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Rich. Aside from owning the club, I've been house flipping and wholesaling since 2017. I used to be a recruiter and do some outside sales. If you've ever heard of Hardybacker, I made those guys a lot of money for about 8 years. And then I was a staffing, like, software engineering recruiter for a number of years as well. So I learned a lot about sales, a lot about cold calling, a lot about generating leads, you know, just a lot of sales tactics that, lo and behold, when I started buying real estate years later, came in kind of handy. So I never really enjoyed sales, mainly because it was like high pressure stuff for other, anybody in a high pressure sales role or been in one before where they're like, you know, you got to hit your quota and they don't even care if you did it last week. And that was the end of the month. If it's the first of the month now, guess what? The clock's reset. It doesn't matter if you made $10 million last year. You got to make $11 million now this month. So, you know, but like I said, it was all a good learning experience for a reason. You know, it definitely made me more confident getting in front of people trying to sell their houses. So, I don't know. We've done like 111 flips together. We got 4 in the works right now. I have 2 flips finishing. And then 2 rentals that I'm trying to get as well, or get rented, actually 3. And I've been doing housing providing or landlording since 2020, and I'm at 11 doors right now. I got like 3 vacancies that I'm trying to fill. So if you need anybody up in the mountains, if you want to live up there, hit me up. I pay referrals. as Jim kind of alluded to, I do have a podcast. If anybody watched this episode yet? It's a good one. It's probably the longest one we've done. I think we were in that studio for like 3 hours. The podcast itself was like 2 hours. But then we were messing around and, you know, this is Jim telling a off-color joke that, you know, we thought was hilarious. But so this is an outtake, actually. But it was a lot of fun. So we also had a lot more fun on the podcast that we actually put onto YouTube. So you can check it out. Or if you want to get on the podcast with me, you go to firechatpodcast.com or scan that code. We film it right over there in the studio. And normally we laugh a lot. I think I have a nice picture of people laughing from like every single podcast. So it's very lighthearted. It's not like we don't, you know, talk about real estate investing also, but we also talk about like, you know, it's more about the people, kind of like this club. You know, it's more about like getting to know you and what your goals are and where you've been and kind of what your story's like and how real estate's fitting into that. So check it out. All right, top ways to find deals. Talk to your neighbors, okay? Now, the thing on the left is my dog. She passed away a couple years ago, but she loved going for walks like most dogs do. And she was a big 60-pound pit bull that was black, and she was super intimidating. As soon as people like realized that she was friendly, they just started talking to you. So I got deals walking her around the neighborhood, or I'd walk her around and take pictures and put them in a deal machine and whatnot. So if you have a dog or you have kids that like to go out, whatever, definitely walk the neighborhood, talk to your neighbors. Like, you know, Evan's been talking about with referrals and all that stuff. You have to talk to your neighbors. They, especially the ones like this guy, you know him. He's the dude. He's lived there for his whole life. He knows everybody. He knows the people that lived in the house before the people that lived in the house and the people before that. And he knows everything. And if there's ever anything that, like, this is stuff that you can't find on People Search or Spokio or Skip Tracing or whatever. Like, you need to talk to the neighbors either in your own neighborhood or in, if you're flipping stuff, talk to the neighbors there. Look around the neighborhood. You know, it's a big one. There was a neighbor at my house. I wasn't too sure about her. She was a little intimidating. But the more I got to know her, she turns out she knew everybody. She'd been there. How old is she? In her 60s, late 60s, early 70s. And she grew up there. She had been playing on my lot, the house my lot's on, like when my house used to be like a one bedroom and now they added on to it. But like she remembered all the people that lived there. There was a house that was around the corner that was in really bad shape. It was her uncle's friend that used to live there and used to own the house. She gave me a phone number to track the owner down, but it ended up not going through. But still, you find this stuff out when you talk to your neighbors. So I can't stress it enough. Like, find the person in the neighborhood who knows what's going on. And it's usually somebody that's, you know, sadly, it's usually somebody that's a little lonely. Like, you know, they're either elderly or whatever, but like, you know, their family, you know, especially up in the mountains or these smaller towns. Yes, sir.
I paid him $300 and he came out and told me exactly where to put it. And this will be the fourth home that I purchased from him.
Yeah.
That he's referred me.
Yeah.
You know? So
it was originally somewhere that you did something in that neighborhood?
No, I mean I've actually bought and sold two houses on that
gotcha.
Street, and I sold him the house he lived in.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
And it's the guy across the street who's
yep.
Yep. It's the gift that keeps giving.
Absolutely. And it's, like you said, it's the gift that keeps giving. And ideally, that's what you all want to get to, is you don't want to have to spend money sending mailers out and cold calling and door knocking and all that stuff. Like, you want this stuff to come to you. So, you know, it's not just your network in here that we're trying to build of investors. It's build your network out there, too. Like, talk to your friends, talk to neighbors, all that stuff. I got friends messaging me now of, like, hey, like, train me, of people that I worked with in Arizona 7 years ago that I just happened to be friends with on Facebook still. I don't really talk to them, but he's like, dude, I'm trying to get into real estate. I moved to here, you know, and so I gave him some homework assignments, and he's working on it, but we'll see. Take a drive. So for those of you, if you're running errands, waiting on an appointment, dropping off the kids, all that stuff, don't just sit there in your car on Instagram. Like, I know you get the dopamine. Thank you. The dopamine hit from it. But I promise you, you're going to get a lot more dopamine hit if you find a house that you end up getting a lead for, or you end up closing it later on. Like, that dopamine hit is way better than Instagram. I promise you. So take a drive. Like, don't just sit in the neighborhood. Just drive around the block. Like, it's amazing how fast you can get five houses and pretty much any neighborhood. Me and Caitlin went to the SD RIA back in the summer, and we were sitting there. It was near a golf course, and gorgeous golf course. I mean, I couldn't even afford to golf there, and we're sitting there, and we're ready to go in, and we're just kind of hanging out, and we're like, we want to go drive the neighborhood for Driving for Dollars. And I, being the inexperienced investor that I am, was like, there's not going to be anything in this neighborhood. Like, are you kidding me? Like, look at around. And she's like, let's go, honey. I'm like, all right, fine. So, of course, and, you know, in fashion, of course, I was wrong, like usual. So we drive around, and I'm not kidding you, like the seventh house down the street. Like, we barely even, like, got out the driveway. The seventh house down the street is, like, this corner house with the weeds all growing all over the place. And for that neighborhood stood out. Like, it definitely needed some help. And I think the owners had passed away. And then there was probably like three or four more as we drove around within like 20 minutes in this like multi-million dollar neighborhood in San Diego. So it doesn't matter where you are. I promise you there's houses out there that are going to need some help. So drive around. And then for those of you ChatGPT AI fans, I didn't draw that. I know. You're shocked that I didn't draw it. But I told ChatGPT, I was like, give me this goofy guy, middle-aged guy in a Jeep driving around looking for houses that need help. And that's what it came up with. So aside from the glasses, it's pretty spot on. And if you have Deal Machine, obviously, if you don't, I'm going to be talking about it a little bit. But really, when you're driving for dollars, I think the worst, aside from not driving, Actually, it's probably even worse than that, is that when you take pictures of your houses and then you never do anything with them. So not only are you wasting your time where you could be on Instagram, you're wasting your gas driving around, and really you're just wasting your time. So if you're not going to do something with it, or you have the habit of not doing something with it, check out this program. It's called Deal Machine, and you take pictures of the houses, and when you put them in, when you take those pictures, it goes into an app in your phone, and it basically saves that property. And then you can decide how often you send postcards to those people later on, or right there in the car. So if you scan that, you get like 15 free postcards from Deal Machine. But it's really a powerful program. It's pretty much the only consistent marketing we've done for the past 4 years, I think, since we found it out in Phoenix. So it's not anything fast. It's not anything instant. I've gotten lucky. I put in a property and got called a couple weeks later, but that's not typical. The one we just got called on, which I'll go through here in a little bit. I don't know, 27 postcards. Took me 4 years to find that one before they called me. But consistency is key. So another big one right now, especially like Jim was talking about, there's lots of houses sitting on the MLS right now. Call those agents, hit the FSBO listings. You don't know what you're going to turn over for, there was a good 2 years there where somebody is like, hey, I found this on the MLS. I was like, yeah, great. It was really hard to find stuff on the MLS. But now, I mean, there's a lot of sitting out there. There's a lot of people that had low interest rates that, are trying to maybe sell and get out and move, but they can't, so subject to opportunities there. There's definitely some stuff on there. I'd recommend, getting a hold of some agents. Like Jim said, have an agent in your back pocket. That's a good one. And, do some business together. Bandit signs. Anybody ever heard of a digital bandit sign? I learned this one a couple years ago. I don't use it as much as I should. But you can post on Craigslist and Facebook Marketplace, and you do a digital bandit sign. So you post like either a for sale house or a for rent house or whatever that's going to let you use a picture, and you post your bandit sign on that listing. So if you wanted to buy a house in Crestline, you go post that thing there. And people that are either looking for rent or whatever, just another way to put up a bandit sign. And then obviously the tried and true bandit signs. We've gotten some calls on this. I don't know if we've really closed the deal off a bandit sign, at least not a mobile home, all that recently, but it seems to come in cycles with all these marketing things. So you'll hear... what was his name that was up here a couple weeks ago, a few weeks ago? Danny. Danny was like, cold calling's dead. I highly disagree. But it does come, he was right that it comes in certain cycles. So like certain things work and everybody jumps on the bandwagon to like one thing. And it kind of comes around and things will die and then they'll come back. And right now, I haven't heard anybody talk about bandit signs in a long time, and I really don't see that many out there at the moment. I mean, there are, but not nearly as much as I did. So I think they're going to be more powerful here. Yes, sir. When you see them, you photograph them. Photograph them. Absolutely.
Yep.
Yep. Yep. Absolutely. Absolutely. And it goes the same way. Other investors, you get calls from other investors, trying to partner up or see what you got going on in the area. And always have a good business card that explains what you do, and door hangers if you are out there door knocking. You always want to bring something with you. Bird dogs, again, this is just networking. Family and friends, like Evan went through on the, a couple things. One of those deals he was talking about one of our family members was a tenant, and lived there a long time, and that's how we got the deal. We've had from the same bird dog, we've gotten she's just a hard worker. She's just a little bit lower income, and she just moves around from houses, to houses. I think she was for a little while. She was married to one of our other guys that was working for us for a little while, and I think we've gotten like four or five houses from her now. And we've paid her, a few grand each time. And that's been really, really lucrative. So, and right now we just got two leads from another one of our guys. So don't sleep on the people that work for you or the people that are around you all the time. Like it says up there, you know, delivery drivers. I live in a small town, so I mean, I know the UPS drivers. I always tell them what I do, and someday I'm confident that one of them will say, "Hey, man, like, have you seen that house over there?" They haven't yet, but I promise you, they're going to one of these days. Because he keeps every few years, he sees me at a different house. He's like, "Damn, dude, you moved again," and he's like, "So, you know, it's coming." Also, is it Tom Nardone? Tom Nardone, the Million Dollar Mailman. Another book, other than John Schaub's book, if you guys want to write that down. He basically made millions while he was working at the post office as a mailman. And now he has all of his old mailman buddies and their families and everybody else that works in the post office still driving for him. So I thought that was really cool. So when I heard that, I had a whole plan together to go after these Uber and DoorDash guys, but then I got busy with a warehouse. And so that's gonna come back around here someday. Old tenants, you know, if you stay good with your tenants, definitely, you know, check them out. And then again, Mrs. Kravitz, you know, that neighbor that knows everything about the neighborhood. Just keep an eye on it. You know, even the ones. Yes, sir.
One of the things about it's not just your neighbors where you live. You rent where your rentals are. I have a Mrs. Kravitz I actually called today, and I was calling the lead and talked to him today. He said, "Yes, Barbara talked about you. I will be calling you when this agency mm-hmm. happens." So that's one other reason there about that. It's don't forget even where your rentals. I know some of you don't want people to know you own the house, but there's a lot of yeah. advantages too.
Yeah.
When they know you own that house or that house.
Yeah, or when they want to sell their house. You know, yeah. like it's you know, I had one of the biggest ones that I've had to deal with was next to my Airbnb, and this woman was just all over me all the time. Like, I mean, you know, you lifted a paintbrush and she's like, "Permit," you know, so, you know, so, but you know, she called me and she's like, "Hey," she was the first call she made when she was thinking about selling her house. I mean, of course the house was worth like 400 and she wanted like 750 for it. And I was like trying to tell her and she's like, no. I was like, whatever. So someday I'll probably still get it, but you just got to sit and wait because there's no way anybody else is going to buy it for 750. So we'll see. But she's still there. She keeps an eye on things. She calls me sometimes. You know, Gary Johnson fans out there. What is it? Cherries and chocolates. Gary Johnson sends out to his pretty much everyone, his tenants, his neighbors, everybody. So I send it out to my neighbors, all my tenants. They get a gift basket from me every year. It changes. Sometimes it's, you know, pears and chocolates. Sometimes it's popcorn, you know, whatever. But I send everybody a little bit Christmas thing, all my tenants and everything like that. It's just a little goodwill that goes a long ways, you know, later down the line. So networking, obviously, the club, other RIAs, meetup, just Toastmasters, Facebook groups, your regular activities, honestly. Like, you know, Evan, I don't even know how many houses or just riding motorcycles or whatever, you know, he's gotten deals with. I at one time on one of my flips had 7 different crews working on the house, and they were all from the bowling alley. My cement guy was from the bowling alley. My painter was from the bowling alley. The drywall guy was from the bowling alley. The electrician was from the bowling alley. Every single one of them was from the bowling alley. So, and those people know people, you know, and trust me, just go bowl. Like, you'll meet a lot of people. Or ride motorcycles, whatever you like to do, go shooting, whatever. Just tell people what you do. Don't be a secret agent. So, so here's some houses that I've done recently. That one up there on the left, this one's a couple years older, but I wanted to put that on there. Got that one for $90,000, and that's up in Crestline. It was a massive house at the time, or I thought it was big at the time. We've done bigger ones since, but that one, until the last one that he was just talking about, was our highest rehab. And I learned a lot on that one, too, but I didn't need scaffolding on that one. So this one won. But anyways, got that for $90,000. I negotiated that with a seller I never met, and I only talked to him on the phone one time, So I negotiated the entire deal through email. He would not pick up the phone. He would not call me. He just wanted to do it all through email so that it was all documented. And I actually have this email completely printed out. And the only time he got on the phone with me was finally at the very end when we had talked all the numbers that he wanted to talk. And it was the final, like, itty-bitty stuff about some of the stuff in the contract. And I was just like, hey, it's going to take me like a book to explain this stuff. Like, just call me. And he finally did. So this one on the right was a Driving for Dollars one as well. And what was I going to say about this one? This one, it looks really bad on the outside, but it was actually pretty good on the inside. It just been neglected. They put on the deck, you can see the... So they built this nice deck out front, which was really odd to me because this house backed up to the National Forest, and it was gorgeous. Like, there was no houses behind it. You literally had like the whole National Forest on the back, bless you. And they built the deck on the front of the house. And I was just like, why? And anyways, so they built this nice deck, and then they put, instead of putting the planks all the way across, the 2x6s to actually be the surface of the deck out back, they decided to sheet it all in OSB. Anybody know what OSB is? Yeah, it's like particle. It's like the stuff that looks like, you know, a bunch of wood chips just smashed together. So it's pretty much cardboard. And so they painted it, at least. But that was like, you know, after 20 years, you could see it just absorbed. It just absorbed all the water and everything. It literally just disintegrated. And because of that, it sat there like a sponge sitting on top of all of the beams and supports and everything like that, and just rotted out this entire deck. So when it came down to flipping this house, we actually tore this deck off because it was going to be $25,000 to fix the deck, or it was going to be $9,000 to tear it all down and just build a staircase right up to the front door. The only thing that was questionable was that they slopped a lot of cement in the basement as like trying to finish the basement. And there was like some odd places that they had put extra supports for the house that didn't make a whole lot of sense. And there was like a trap door in the back of this closet that you went down into the basement from, so you didn't have to go outside. And that was a little questionable too. But no, I mean, the rest of the house is pretty solid. We ended up doing a little bit of work and painted inside, and we didn't replace the carpet in that house. We had it cleaned. So it worked out pretty well. So my point in showing this to you, though, is those two houses were from Deal Machine. So the first one was the one that I put on Deal Machine. I got a call like a week and a half later. I got the email a week and a half later. That was on the email. And then the one on the right, that one actually didn't take too long either. That was only like 6 months before I got a call on that. And it was right around the corner from another project we were doing. So again, I really believe in this program, and we'll go through more. So this is one we ended up wholesaling, actually. This is in Twin Peaks, and it just needed more work than we really felt like getting into. We couldn't get down into the basement because I don't even remember why. There was someone there that was just filled with so much junk, but honestly, we didn't want to clear the place out. This place was so packed full of crap and it was these stairs, which lo and behold, the stairs were less than what I'm going to get into in a second, but at that time, we just really didn't feel like doing it. So we wholesaled that one. But like I said, we drove the neighborhood. Didn't take that long. So if you can see the house right next to our store to it, right there, you can't really see it in this picture, but there's a very telling roof there. That's a metal roof, and it's pretty, you'd recognize it if you saw it. But so we put this one, we got off regular old mailers. And then that one next to it, I put that into Deal Machine 4 years ago. 4 years ago. And they finally called us. We sent them 27 postcards over those 4 years. It cost us, those postcards cost about 50 cents each, plus the system that we paid for Deal Machine for, you know, a couple years. But still, if I had to figure it out, I don't know, maybe $500 tops in marketing. We got that house for $90,000. I'm going to put $100 into it. It needs it, and it's probably, if I decide to sell it, we'll see, debating keeping it as a rental, but if I decide to sell it, it should go for like $325, $350, something around there, okay? So
very
Terrible return. Terrible return. So, and if you do this long enough, you'll run into sometimes cute animals, sometimes dangerous animals, sometimes cute and dangerous animals together. And every once in a while, you'll have a little excitement in here.
I went upstairs and found some friends, huh?
Oh my God, he's right there.
Oh, yeah, see him? See him?
Yeah.
Yeah, they'll tear your freaking face off.
Yeah.
So he literally chased us out of the house. We were upstairs and we were being loud. I mean, we were talking, looking around the house, and then we went upstairs and there was a bed on the floor, and all of a sudden this thing jumps out. I thought it was a cat, like ran underneath, and then it came out. I was like, oh shit, it's a raccoon. Get out of here, because I mean they'll mess you up if they got big old, they're cute trash pandas and memes and stuff, but they got big old claws that are not fun. So, yes, sir. We got in there and we got really loud. We put some music in there and they eventually left on their own. And then as soon as they were out, we plugged up the holes that they were getting into. And we got lucky because I was trying to trap them. I have another video of me like peering around the corner and this thing, like I set a trap for it. I put cat food in it, did all of that. And this thing literally just walked into the, I couldn't get this trap to like stay triggered or whatever, what do you call it? Set? Thank you. I couldn't get this thing to stay set. I mean, I literally like moved it a little bit and the thing would spring. And I finally got it to go. And then this freaking raccoon literally got inside the whole trap, ate the whole can of cat food clean, like not just a little bit. Like this thing looked like it had been washed with a sponge and got back out without setting it off. I was just like, dude, you go. Like you can have the house, forget it. Like, I don't know. So anyways, again, that was Deal Machine. And then this one, we just picked up in Running Springs. That was a Subject 2 house. That was my now first house that I essentially got for free. So I did pay the closing costs, which cost me about $6,000. But this person was a member in the club, and she had gotten into a situation where she had two houses. She was making two house payments. And she knew that I, you know, bought stuff up there. So originally I intended on giving her quite a bit of money down to do this deal. But then once we got into it, there was a lot more work that I needed. The pictures didn't really do it justice. You know, it needed about as much money as I was going to give her. So we ended up working a deal where basically we took over the house. We solved the problem. Her problem was that she had two mortgage payments and she had this thing on the market. Her agent told her, don't worry, don't do anything. Just put it on the market for top dollar. She had this thing listed at 540 something. Then she dropped it down to like 499. And basically she was going to sell this thing if she was lucky for 460 by the time she got out of it and paid her agent and blah, 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 blah. She would have walked away with nothing if she was lucky. Most likely she was going to probably end up having to spend money to get out of it. So we solved the problem. And now her problem is my problem. And that's how that works. So, but that's the most recent Subject 2 one. We did one a couple years ago with a VA where we actually, I think it was more like an assumption than a sub two, but it's a great house. It was built in 85. It's built really well. It's just a big ass house but she had a 2.9 interest rate. So even if I can't get it to cash flow immediately, I'm capturing the pay down on the loan and hopefully not having too much maintenance. So I'm trying to, right now we're kind of figuring out what to do with it. But anyways, so that one was exciting. And really what this all comes down to, and how to have this conversation with people is the old Peter Fortunato line, why would you sell such a nice house as this? So that is the key to everything. It's what, you know, really drives, you want to solve people's problems, okay? There's a lot of sales stuff that goes into this and controlling the conversation and trying to, you know, get people to come to a number first, and then you negotiate and you meet in the middle and blah, 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 blah. That all goes into it, but really where it all starts is solving the person's problem for them. That's what matters. And that's what we're really here for. So all we do is we solve problems. So if you want to learn how to solve problems, who's heard of Firefest? Right on. So people have been, we did this program back in March. People have been begging us to do it again, and we pretty much gave it away in March, and you know, we did it way higher than we even thought. We didn't even promise food then. We ended up feeding everybody for like 6 weeks, went on way more field trips than we even intended, but it was an awesome program. And we've really been wanting to put it back together, but we've been a little busy with everything going on in the club. But I'm excited. It's coming back, so we're going to do it in January 4th to February 8th. There's going to be 6 weeks of dedicated meetings again, so that's going to be every Thursday night, from about 6 to 8, same as this. So every 6 weeks every Thursday. And then there's going to be at least three field trips a week. And those field trips are anything from like going and looking at these properties that we have under contract, that we're getting ready to start doing. If we can, maybe we'll take a couple people into, meetings with sellers, as long as you promise not to say anything until afterwards. Then you can ask all the questions you want. But really, just we're stepping up the game. It's going to come with a manual this time. We're going to do the food. It's going to be a lot more polished than it was last time. And basically, it's like accelerating yourself to your next deal, 6 weeks to get your next deal. Okay, so it doesn't really matter. The last one we targeted towards people that were brand new. This one is brand new, or if you are having trouble finding a deal, or you've done deals before, or you're having trouble getting to your next deal, maybe getting started again, this is for you. So we had a lot of success with the last one. Multiple people do deals, big checks. Who saw Beto on stage? Yeah, so you'll see him again here in a second. So we put this little video together. Check it out.
All right, so what was your biggest fear?
Standing right here right now. Just talking to people.
Biggest fear is running numbers, the resources too.
Cold calling. Okay, I call that lady.
Biggest fear I had is that this is like 100% what we do. You know, from a normal check to now this, and it's like, it's kind of scary.
Getting into something that was going to be a financial mess, I guess a lack of confidence in making sure I get a right deal.
Imposter syndrome.
Biggest fear, honestly, was cold calling.
Was that I wouldn't be able to answer the seller's questions.
Not really knowing exactly what to do, like how to do it, how, you know, knowing where to start and the whole process of making a deal.
What was your biggest win or takeaway?
I think it was the mindset. I thought I couldn't, you know, be here or do the things that I'm doing. And now I feel like I can do it.
Oh, that's awesome. And I found out you don't have to do it. I could just find somebody in here that is looking for that, and I can go in there and go, hey, I don't have to keep everything that we see.
Taking consistent action, making the cold calls, doing the door knocking, talking to the neighbors, just implementing everything, I can feel it getting very close to a deal.
Sitting down and talking to a friend in the group or a colleague who had some other ideas, all of those pieces.
Definitely the confidence and the knowledge I've gained, and I'm making the offer.
Now I can reach out to homeowners. I can reach out to realtors. I actually entered two escrows.
Two escrows, she's going.
Jumping the hurdles of cold calling and door knocking.
Being able to sit down to write up the offer with Jim and Sky and David.
Networking with all of you guys, just knowing that you guys had my back.
So we netted $52,250, which is your check for $26,000, whatever it is.